Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service from St. Mary's, Rushden. We have a wonderful service for you today, some excellent music by our music group and Rosemary on the organ. Mick will be preaching the last in our current series on Paul in Acts, and Jo Molum will be giving us her children's slot for today. So plenty of excitement and interest there, I'm sure. Before we continue, just to remind everyone listening to this that, of course, we are worshiping in church regularly each Sunday, both at 9:30 and 11:15 a.m. So anytime you feel ready to come and join us there, you'd be most welcome. In the meantime, you're most welcome to join with us for worship here and now. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
I just wanted to show you this. It's a card that a friend gave me quite some time ago, and you can see it's got a man caught in a rainstorm. He's about to step into a great big puddle It's lots of wind and rain and snow, and his brolly's turned out the wrong way. He's having a pretty rough time. Okay, I don't know if you can see what it says at the bottom though. It says, whatever the weather, Jesus is there. And that reminds me a bit of all the things we've been learning about Paul over the last few weeks. Paul has been having a really, really rough time, and we're going to carry on with that story today. Okay, and you can see in the picture on the in the book. Look at that. Poor old Paul. In today's story, Paul gets shipwrecked. Okay, so Paul was put on a ship with the other prisoners, and at first the journey went well, but then the wind changed. The ship slowed down, and by the time it reached Crete, it was running late. Was Paul worried? Not at all. He knew it wasn't a good time of year to sail, and if the ship stayed in Crete, everything would be all right. And that's what he told the men in charge, but they didn't want to wait. So off they sailed across the choppy sea. It didn't take long for Paul's warning to come true. A hurricane blew up and the boat was blown like a toy across the water. The sailors did everything they could. They dropped the anchor, they threw the cargo overboard, they held the battered boat together with ropes, but the storm went on and on until all the food had run out and it looked like everyone was going to die. Was Paul worried? Not at all. He knew God would keep them safe. Calmly he stood and spoke to the others. I had a visit last night from the angel. He told me that we would get to Rome safely. The ship will be destroyed, run aground on an island, but we will all survive. And that's just what happened. The ship was wrecked off the island of Malta. At first the soldiers and sailors thought only of themselves, but Paul convinced the men in charge that the angel's promise would only come true if everyone stuck together. So that's what they did, and everyone was saved. The people who lived on the island took care of the castaways, and after 3 months they joined another ship sailing to Rome. In that big city, Paul had to stay in his house until his trial, so while he waited, he told everyone who visited him about Jesus. Was Paul worried about what would happen to him? Not at all. Instead, he was busy writing letters to all the churches he'd started all over the world. And in one letter he said, don't be worried, just be thankful and tell God what you need. Jesus will give you the peace of God, and that will help you to face anything. You see, that reminds me of my little card. Whatever the weather, Jesus is there. And there's a lovely prayer on the back of this card that I'd like to share with you as well. Dear Lord, sometimes my life has storms and sunshine. Thank you, Jesus, for your peace and protection through all the rough patches, as well as the happy times. Amen. So to remind us of that, I thought we could make a little craft of our own. You're going to need half a circle. You could use half a paper plate. I've just folded a circle piece of paper. Then we need a longer strip of paper. I've coloured mine brown, and we're going to glue them together so that you have this. Okay, I think you can see how this is going to work. Then get a triangle of paper, and we're going to put some glue on that and stick it onto the mast of our boat, and it's already looking like a little boat. Then I've got another little triangle that we can stick. There we go. And here is a little sailing boat. And to remind us, because this is half a circle, it will stand. And to remind us, we can write, whatever the weather, Jesus is there. You see? And it reminds us that Jesus is there to listen and to help us. See you next week, guys.
We now come to that point in our service when we come before God in humility, but also in confidence, because we worship a God who wants nothing more than to forgive us, to strengthen us, send us out in His Spirit and in His strength to live His life and do His will in our families and communities. So we come to Him in confession. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And so we pray together the words on the screen. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Oh. Good morning. Our reading this morning comes from Acts chapter 27, beginning to read at verse 13. The storm. When a gentle south wind began to blow, they saw their opportunity. So they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Before very long, a wind of hurricane force, called the Northeaster, swept down from the island. The ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed through the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure, so the men hoisted it aboard. Then they passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together. Because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbars of Syrtis, they lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering in the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. After they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, "Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have saved yourself this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. Last night an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood before me and said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island.' On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea, when about midnight the sailors sensed they were approaching land. They took soundings and found that there was water 120 feet deep. A short time later, they took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. Fearing that we'd be dashed against the rock, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, 'Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved.' So the soldiers cut the rope that held the lifeboat and let it drift away. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat. 'For the last 14 days,' he said, 'you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head.' After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. Altogether, there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. When daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay of a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow struck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to just jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks or in any other pieces of the ship. In this way, everyone reached land safely. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Mick Banting. I'm part of the team here at St Mary's, and today we're going to have a talk on Acts chapter 27, verses 13 to 44. If you've got a Bible to hand, that'd be great, because it's always good to follow along. Paul, we've followed over the last few weeks, is on his journey spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ, and everywhere he goes, there are those that accept. And there's a lot of Jews that just won't accept his message, and they stir up trouble whenever he goes. Now, Steve has given this the title Shipwreck. And we're going to look at a real shipwreck for Paul. But we're also going to see, how does shipwreck in our life apply to us? Because it wouldn't be much point having this talk if we couldn't apply it to our own lives. So we'll look at it together. If we were to ask an average person the question, will life be, as a Christian, much better, much worse, or how will it be? How would they answer, or how would you answer? Well, some people think that being a Christian means that God won't let bad things happen to them. I don't know what you think. Well, there's three ways I think that our lives actually do get shipwrecked. And it's very unusual that Father God does do the shipwrecking. Two of those ways we'll be looking at in a moment. But first of all, God does sometimes intervene and have to really bring us up by our heels if we're going the wrong way. God's people, those that he loved and he saved, and he led out of Egypt and took them into the promised land, they abused his love. Terribly. They did terrible, detestable things, sexual things, they worshipped foreign gods, and they even did child sacrifice at the bottom of the pit, as it were, of their lives. And God had to do something about it, and he sent his people off into captivity. But that didn't mean that God doesn't love them, and doesn't love us if he has to pull us up by our heels. So God does sometimes use circumstances, and we might feel it's a shipwreck of our lives, but to bring us back to his love. He loves us. It's worth sort of noting that God actually says, it gives me no pleasure to bring suffering to my people. I would rather that they would turn away from their wickedness and sins and come back to me and love me. Well, I said that there's two other ways that our lives become shipwrecked. So let's look at the first together. Over my life, I've seen many examples where even Christians shipwreck their own lives and the lives of their family, friends and all around. Perhaps sometimes when a husband or a wife becomes unfaithful, it turns the whole family life upside down. It wrecks it, a shipwreck of their lives. Children's lives are wrecked. The husband and wife's lives are wrecked. Grandparents' lives are wrecked. It's just a total wreck. Everything gets changed. Another way is sometimes people are overworking. And for the wrong reasons. They're not doing it just to support their families. They do it so they can have the best of everything. The best car, the best house, the best holidays, the best clothes, etc., etc. What happens then is because they're away from the house so much, things break down. The children don't have any discipline because the father or mother's not there. And their lives get wrecked. And gradually, bit by bit, there's another shipwreck in. Also, I've seen people get mixed up in fraud, stealing. All those things are a shipwrecking of lives and in a downward circle. And then there's substance abuse, maybe drinking, over-drinking, dependence on drink or drugs. I was very fortunate to listen to a talk by Mr. Shipham. You'll see his pastes in the supermarket, Shipham's pastes, meat pastes and fish pastes, etc. His life was totally shipwrecked by his over-drinking, becoming an alcoholic. And if it wasn't for the love of God turning him round and bringing him to Jesus, his life would never have been put back together. But praise God, he had a testimony to tell us how God brought him back from that. I'm sure that you could think of many other ways that we actually bring on a shipwreck of our lives ourselves. So many of them. They're the thing to note, they're all of our own making. They're not what Father God does to us. So let's look at the second way of our lives that go down in a shipwreck. There's sickness, not brought on by ourselves. Death of a loved one. Even when you may have had a very healthy life and tried everything you can to stay healthy, there's still going to be death. Losing a job is devastating, absolutely devastating. The income goes right down, and maybe the loss of a house. You might be in a place at the wrong time, as we say, and there's a landslip or a train crash. They're not things that we've brought on. They're just life shipwrecking. The fact is that these and many more happenings will come our way. They will. And it'll seem like our whole world is just falling apart. Totally, totally shipwrecked. Why then are we God's people that say, well, these things shouldn't happen to us? Well, first of all, we're all part of this broken world, both Christians and non-Christians. We're not God's puppets, you see. We're not. That if a bad thing happens, he will pick Christians up, will he, and save them, put them down in another place like a puppet? No. No, he doesn't move us around like that and keep us out of danger all the time. Let me give you an example. You may have taught your child to ride a bicycle. You started off, you got a new bike for them, you made sure it was good, and then you run around holding that saddle until the time they could just go off on their own, and you let them go. And then they wanted to go out at the evening and go on their bike, and you let them. That's proper, and that's good. And that's what God does with us. He puts us in the world and lets us get on with our lives. Now, you wouldn't be able to stop your child from having an accident when they're out on their bike, heaven forbid. And God lets us go through life, and there will be bad things happening to us. You might say, why? Why then should I give my life to Jesus and become a Christian if it's not going to be any better? So let's hear Father God's own words to his people, and that's us also. He says, when I made a covenant, that's an agreement with you, to love you, I can never, never break it. I am Almighty God, there is no other like me, my covenant agreement will stand. I love you no matter what, and that's for all time. You will live with me forever, and nothing will separate us ever. And it says in Romans, let me just read it to you. This is Paul actually speaking. He says, no, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present or the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Now in our passage in Acts, if you've got your Bible there, on chapter 27:13, we find Paul in a real shipwreck situation. In fact, this was nothing new for Paul. He was shipwrecked three times. And one time, in fact, he was in the water for a day and a half. He tells us also in his life, in 2 Corinthians 11, that he had been put in prison frequently, flogged often, exposed to death many times. Five times he was given 39 lashes, three times beaten with rods, stoned, and now this shipwrecking that we're mentioning. Well, the reason that Paul was on this passage was because in trying to spread the good news of Jesus, and he had been chosen by Jesus to do that, while he was trying to spread it, the Jews were always plotting to do away with him, kill him. And he had caused, they said, an uproar. So he got put into prison. He was arrested by the Romans because it looked like there was going to be a terrible uproar. And when he came before different governors, it got to a point where he called his trump card. Being Roman, he could say, I appeal to Caesar. Now, to appeal to Caesar means that you must go to Rome and put your case there. And for Paul, this was a great chance because it'd be a great chance to take the gospel to Rome, the capital, where everything happened from. So he had appealed to Caesar, and he was now a prisoner, and the way to get to Rome was by boat. So on this journey he goes. Now, we know that there's 276 people on this ship, so it's not too small. And we've got Luke, who is the author of Acts that we're reading, and Luke's gospel with him. So we're getting a very detailed account. We're so grateful for Luke's account. And he tells us of all the different perils that they have. But something that really stands out is that as a Christian, Paul is really respected, and the centurion in charge looks up to him in some ways and trusts him. In fact, when they put into one port, because it's going to take many ports to get there, he's allowed under house arrest to go and see his friends. So there's that time. Another time, they pull into Fair Haven, it says. Now, Paul urged them to stay there for the winter, because after that sort of time, there was always going to be trouble at sea. You may know that going round the Bay of Biscay, and I've done that at the wrong time of year. It was a bit of a foolish thing to do. And we were on this cruise ship, and it was horrible. But Paul urges them. But unfortunately, it's not the sort of place that everyone wanted to stay for winter. So the captain and the centurion moves them on. And true to Paul's word, they get into trouble. And they don't have the navigation that we have today. And they're pushed out to sea and out to sea until they can see no land. And everything is dark. And 14 days later, they haven't eaten, they haven't seen stars, they haven't got a clue where they are. They think that they might be able to make land. They get rid of all the cargo, it tells us in our Bibles, and they start to, but the water's going down and down, and suddenly they're on the banks. Now, there's a lot of detail in there that you can read, but Paul has said to the centurion that he has had a visit from one of God's angels last night, and they can all be saved if they stay together now and then try and make for the coast. So the centurion sends those that can swim on first and the others to try and float in. Now I want to briefly just say one thing there. Be prepared to see or hear angels. We don't worship them. We don't give them lots and lots of praise. None at all, actually. But God has said that he will send his angels, those who see his face, to be around us. And I'd like to talk to you another time about that. So, they get to the coast and they all get there safe. And that's the important thing. So, to finish, I want to remind us that there is really, really God in the middle of every one of our shipwreck incidents of our lives. And I want us to take away from this today to bring our own shipwrecks to our Lord, because none of us know from day to day how our lives are going to change, not from one day to the next or the moment to the next. And we must be prepared to stand up for Jesus no matter how hard it gets. And to finish completely, I want to remind you of a little passage that I've got here. I'm sure you've come across it. And if not, look it up online. It's called Footprints. And I'll read it to you to just finish off. One night I dreamed that I was walking along the beach with the Lord. Many scenes from my life flashed across the sky, and each scene I noticed footprints in the sand. Sometimes there were two sets of footprints, other times there was one set of footprints. Well, this bothered me, as I noticed that during the low periods of my life, when I was suffering from anguish, sorrow, or defeat, I could see only one set of footprints. So I said to the Lord, "You promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I've noticed that during the most trying period of my life, there have only been one set of footprints in the sand. Why then? I needed most you to be there for me." And the Lord replied, as he replies to us, each one of us, "The times when you have seen only one set of footprints, my child, was when I carried you." Amen.
Thank you.
We now affirm our faith together using an affirmation based on verses from Revelations chapters 4 and 5. We say together in faith, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We believe in God the Father, who created all things, for by his will they were created and have their being. We believe in God the Son, who was slain, for with his blood he purchased us for God from every tribe and language, from every people and nation. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit. The Spirit and the bride say, Come, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Shall we pray? Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, this world feels like we're in a storm, approaching shipwreck even, but we know that you are still in control. We give you thanks and praise that you are the salvation of the world. You are the hope of all who trust in you. We pray for your church throughout the world. Give strength to those who minister to others while facing violence, poverty, and disease. Give encouragement to our mission partners working throughout this pandemic in unstable parts of the world. Help us to overcome our fear and to proclaim your kingdom throughout this community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of justice and peace, you hold all the nations and their rulers in your hands. We pray for those countries where there is war, oppression, and civil strife. For Belarus, Lebanon, Syria, and the United States. Let your mercy and your justice come to these countries and to their people. Guide all those who are fighting into your truth and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of all creation, there's plenty in this world for all, yet many are hungry, in our country and across the world. We pray for those parts of the world where there is drought. We pray for Kenya facing locust swarms. And we pray for all those out of work from the current pandemic in our own society. Help us to know how to best use the resources you have given. Help us to be generous with all you've given to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, we pray for our congregation and our community around Rushden. Thank you that we can meet together now. Thank you for the technology of computers and phones that help us to meet even when we can't get together. Be with those who feel lonely and help us to know how best to encourage them. Make us a people who forgive and reach out to our enemies as you have forgiven and reached out to us. Give a fresh vision to our church to build your kingdom in this place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing and strength, we pray for those who are ill, housebound, isolating, or recovering from illness. We pray that you will touch them with your healing and give them your peace. We pray in particular for those of our own congregation and those who are known to us in our own circle of family and friends. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray too for those who have recently lost loved ones. Be near to them. Hold them in your loving hands and give them your comfort and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The Collect for the 12th Sunday after Trinity. God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness, increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And gathering our prayers and praises into one, we pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Stronger, God is higher than any.
Now we bring this act of worship to a close as we commend one another to God's care through the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.